Hello, my name is Bruce Melville. I'm your narrator for this Mott Lake adventure. The Mott Lake adventure started as a plan for a backpacking trip. We kind of set a date 2 months in advance, but we really didn't know where we were going to go. But after some research on the internet and reading some trail guides, I determined that Mott Lake would be a great destination. So we set out on Thursday, July 16th, 2009 at 6 o'clock in the morning. We got in Pat McDonough's van and we drove the 2.5 hour drive to Edison Lake, where we stopped at the Vermilion Valley Resort. That's at 7,700 elevation. And we went into the store and we talked about getting a ferry ride. This trip required a ferry ride across Edison Lake. It would save us 4.5 miles of hiking. So we purchased our tickets at $18 a person for the round trip. And we got back to Pat's van and we prepared to unload all our gear. And then we hiked down to the ferry. We were a little early, so we spent some time practicing survival methods in case we fell in the water, and then we went off on our journey. Standing at the front of the boat, sticking her head through the gate, Mara was in dog heaven, this being far superior than hanging out your head out the door of any car. Well, our ferry ride proved to be smooth and uneventful, and as we reached the other end of the lake, we could see the beautiful Vermilion Cliffs to our north on our left, and we also saw some weary and hungry backpackers waiting for this ferry ride back to the restaurant and civilization and a warm bed. We also were met by a marmot who protested that we had a dog with us and let that protest be known by loud chirping. We were fortunate to have one of the hikers take our picture together before we set off, and then we waved goodbye to the ferry. As it left, we found the trailhead. It was about 9:45 when we started our hike, got our maps out, hiked just about a few hundred yards, and then we entered the John Muir Wilderness Area. This is a protected wilderness area, preserved for special purposes, and we set off on our hike. The weather was clear, sunny, about 65 degrees as we headed off. We could see the beautiful Vermilion Cliffs to our left for this first quarter mile, and then we hit an area where it was marshy and wet and green with flowers blooming and covered by trees. And fortunately, someone had built a bridge or walkways for 100 yards or so that kept us from walking through the marsh. Really nice way to set off our pace. And as your body starts getting adjusted to the weight of the 40-pound weight of your pack, and you get your stride going. After a half mile, the trail splits, with the trail going to your right, which is south, which is the Selden Pass. But we needed to go north to the Silver Pass to connect to the Mott Lake trailhead. As you can see, we had a dead serious look about going, and Mara was pacing in anticipation, and she didn't want to stop and go, so we headed on. After we hiked for a while, we had to forge a couple of the tributaries of the Mono Creek. We could see great vistas of black granite peaks in the distance as we headed on. After about 2.5 hours of hiking, we come to where the trail splits again. This time, the trail split going due east and continuing north, the direction we needed to go on the Silver Pass. We stopped here. The McDonoughs hadn't had any lunch yet, so we stopped at the creek. We took our packs off. We took a good half-hour break, ate some trail mix. Pat and Nathaniel brought sandwiches, and we got a little reprise as we knew we still had a long hike ahead of us. So after that, we pressed on. This trail now followed along the creek and went into a canyon with beautiful granite cliffs on our east side, and then we walked to this beautiful grove of aspen trees. I've never seen aspen trees so tall, somewhere 100 foot tall, foot and a half in diameter, with leaves that just danced in the wind. What a beautiful sight. This would be a great place to visit in the fall, because as these trees turn bright colors of orange and yellow and red, it'd be a beautiful thing to see. After we got about our fourth hour of hiking, the temperature had risen to probably 75 degrees, and with a steady uphill climb, our bodies were starting to stress, and we were sweating. We were drinking plenty of water, but still, our energy levels were starting to drop. We came to the spot where the water made a bend right in front of us, and it was so crystal clean and clear and cool, I suggested to Pat that we go ahead and take our packs off and dip our shirts in the water and put our shirts on to cool us off. Putting the shirts back on was a little difficult though. Well, with the refreshing coolness of our wet t-shirts, Pat and I were renewed. The boys had left us behind about 20 minutes earlier, and they were up ahead of the trail a few minutes. And so we headed off to our next break on the trail. Well, after 4 miles of hiking, we came to the Mott Lake turnoff. And I look at this sign now and I just have to laugh, because the sign shows the arrow going to the right. But if you looked at the trail went straight up the mountain, so the arrow actually should have pointed straight up to be more accurate. Well, this part of the trail was the part I knew would be difficult and challenging, especially after already hiking for 4 hours. The first part of the trail went straight up with switchbacks, very demanding, air very thin, and it was slow going. Fortunately, the trail met up with another creek, and it followed along the creek. Again, it was beautiful vistas. This creek had areas where the water came down, and rigged long, huge granite rocks with water flowing over it. And it looked like water slides. Lots of wildflowers. Across the river again, and then we came to a different type of area we haven't been to before. It was opened up into a valley, kind of a marshy valley. Beautiful granite landscaping all around. Fortunately, we were out in the open, and with all the humidity of all the water around, even though it was about 70, 75 degrees, it really felt like it was more like 80 degrees. And we were running out of gas. So we were in about our sixth hour of hiking. Our energy levels were getting low. It was hot. Humidity was high. trail became a little harder to follow because there was high brush that we had to actually force our way through. And there were some marshy sections we had to walk through. And Pat and I stopped at a little stream, filled up our bottles with water, because we wanted to keep from being dehydrated. Because the last little bit was going to be really steep again. Then we came upon the sign that said, "No 10,000 feet, no fires above this elevation." Well, Pat and I looked at each other and thought, oh great, backpacking without any campfires? Well, we were determined to figure something out. We had a little ways to go. We had some steep section with big gold granite rocks to walk over, but we managed to get through, got to the lake. It was beautiful, glorious, fantastic. The boys had got there about 20 minutes earlier. They were dehydrated, out of water, so we pulled out the pump. Aaron pumped water. Nathaniel wanted some directly from the lake. It was cool, refreshing, and great. So we laid there on the grassy shore for about a half hour. And then we were up, ready for the task of finding a campsite. We had to explore the whole lake to find the best campsite since we're going to be there for three more days. And so we set out. We decided to go around the right side of the lake. I had a customer tell me that the best campsite on this lake was by the waterfall. So as we came around, we found one campsite. It was okay, but we have four tents and we need four flat areas for tents, and we didn't have enough room. We got in front of the waterfall, saw a very nice campsite with plenty of flat area, great view of the lake, great view of the waterfall. But I was told there was a really nice one above the waterfall, so I made off with my pack on, explored the top of the waterfall, and determined there was nothing suitable there. So we yelled across to go ahead and set camp there at the waterfall. And we put our gear out, set up our tents, our air mattresses, sleeping bags, set the boys down to the waterfall to get some fresh water, and we basically then just crashed and did some housekeeping. We did find a fire pit over there, so we decided to go ahead and build fires, and we had the boys collect firewood. We lit a fire and we proceeded to make dinner. We had macaroni and cheese and spaghetti and meatballs, and we sat around the fire for a few minutes, and by 9 o'clock we were all ready for bed. So we got just a few minutes to look at the lake and went to sleep. We did discover something that evening. The waterfall that we were next to was beautiful, but it had one downfall. It was so incredibly loud that while we're in the campsite, all we could hear was the waterfall, and it was even hard to communicate with each other, as most questions were answered with "huh." We learned that we had to talk very loud around the waterfall in order to hear each other, but it did allow us to have a deep restful sleep, as it blocked all the other strange sounds you hear when you're in the high country. When morning broke, it was early and everyone else was asleep, so I got up, decided to take a look around, went down to the lake, and I saw that there's something going on at the lake near the shore to my left, and it was two fish, and they were either mating or fighting, and their fins were sticking out of the water sometimes, and the water was only about a foot deep. It was a really interesting thing. I'd never seen that before, so it was great to catch it on video. Well, everybody else came up. We had potatoes and eggs fried up on the fire. Delicious. Some had fried eggs, some had scrambled eggs. So we set off for today's plan, and today's plan was explore the lake, do some fishing, and kind of rest up our bodies for the big hike for tomorrow. So I didn't take my camera, so I didn't catch a lot of the fishing. We spent at least a good 3 or 4 hours fishing. Pat was generous to bring my camera around later, and I got pictures. I got a picture of Aaron catching this fish. But we caught a total of, Aaron caught a total of 17 fish, and Nathaniel caught two, and I think Pat caught one or two, and I caught about 18. Well, it was getting early afternoon, and the boys decided to finish hiking the rest of the way around the lake onto this granite rock. It had a sheer drop off to the water. But the weather started getting bad. It was, the clouds had been kind of forming, but they all bunched together into one big cloud, and it was apparent it would likely get some rain. So we headed back to camp. We had a light lunch, whatever we could find there, and it started to rain. Thunder and rain. It was a nice light rain. It wasn't that cold. It was only still in, possibly in the 70s. Offered us an opportunity to go in and take a little nap. So we all headed to our tents and took a nap. I got up about 20 minutes later and decided to see what everybody was doing. And Nathaniel and Pat were still in their tents. And I went over to Aaron's tent and he was just laying there. So I asked him if he could play some cards. So I spent a few minutes playing Rummy with Mara helping. And after about an hour or so, the rain stopped. The sun came out and it was absolutely beautiful. The air was clean and crisp and I felt renewed and refreshed. So I said, Aaron, let's go over and check out above the waterfall. So we hiked up above the waterfall. A lot of beautiful green vegetation and flowers blooming. And we hiked over to that ridge that the boys were on. I took some pictures. I sat on this ledge and looked straight down about 200 feet to the water. Some strange pictures with Aaron, and then there was a small waterfall that we explored. Well, after we did that, we got back, and it was still about 3:30, and everyone else was up, and I said, well, you know what? We've got to go to Rosy, Finch, and Bighorn Lake tomorrow, so let's take a few minutes and hike over to Blue Jay Lakes. Looks like it's only a half hour on the maps. So let's go. So everyone agreed, and we started hiking. Unfortunately, I did a lousy job reading the map. We kind of got disoriented exactly where north was, so we started actually in the right direction, and we ended up figuring out that to get to the lakes, we had to go straight up. So Pat and I and the boys headed straight up the ridge. The boys went more south of us because it looked like it was a way to go around. And, it was hard going. It was straight up. Shale was loose and the air was thin. But we finally decided that Pat and I were going to go to the lower Blue Jay Lakes. Since the boys were already up higher, we sent them off to the higher Blue Jay Lakes, giving them directions. And Pat and I hiked until we ran out of hillside, and we looked down and we found the lower Blue Jay Lakes, but it was a straight drop-off. There's no way we could get there. So Pat and I decided that we'll go due east and see the upper Blue Jay Lakes where the boys were. And the only way to get there was through a ridge that was straight up. And a funny thing happened. All this time, Mara was with the boys, and just before we cleared the ridge, there was these big, well, there was these caverns or caves that looked like a mountain lion could hide in. And just as we passed those, Mara came up upon Pat, and he thought it was a mountain lion, and he jumped. But it was just Mara who found us. She was concerned about us. So we got to the upper Blue Jay Lakes. The boys, it was already a half hour gone by them and already headed back towards camp. And as you can see, there was ice in one of the ponds, and then the bigger area, the snow was right down to it. It was a dead lake, no fish in it, but it was still a beautiful sight. And again, the clouds started to build up, and there was thunder in the distance, so Pat and I said, well, it's nice seeing the lakes, but let's get out of here before we get electrocuted. So we hiked down the hill, got back to camp. Pat and I cleaned these fish. These are the beautiful fish that we caught. The biggest fish being the one Nathaniel caught in the center, and the other three fish I caught. And we prepared for a feast for dinner that night. We had mashed potatoes, fish, and we had a package of lasagna. After dinner, we did some house cleaning. We did the dishes. Pat, after a day of hiking, went down to the lake to wash off. As the sun set on the ridges, the beautiful colors were cast down on the lake. We sat around and we got to hear about all the jobs Pat had. He was going through high school and college, and how he met Pam, and had a glorious evening. That night we stayed up probably till about 10 o'clock, and we went to bed fully fulfilled. What a great and wonderful day on our second day of our adventure. On Saturday, we woke up bright and early. This is the really big day, the day we pull out all the stops. The last day of hiking before we head out on Sunday and go home. So we hooked up a hearty meal of blueberry pancakes and garlic chicken sausages. Pat McDonough was generous to bring the Trader Joe's blueberries, and I cooked up pancakes for everyone and scrambled eggs for Aaron. There was a little batter left over, and so Pat was generous to finish up cooking the pancakes while I ate. I just love pancakes. So with full stomachs and great anticipation in our minds, we headed out.
Keep rolling, 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 though the streams are swollen, keep them doggies rolling, right. Through rain and wind and weather, hell-bent leather, wishing my gal was by my side. All the things I'm missing, good Beatles, love and kissing, are waiting at the end of my ride. Move 'em on, hit 'em up, move 'em on, hit 'em up, rawhide. Cut 'em out, ride 'em in, cut 'em out, ride 'em in, rawhide.
So we started off heading due north from our campsite, and after a hike by a waterfall, hiked over some large boulders, and then we opened up into this beautiful valley. There's no trail, but we just followed along the creek, and as you can see, it was lush green with flowers everywhere, and the creek was running. We dubbed this valley Marmot Valley because there was marmots everywhere on both sides, and they were all sounding the warning that there was a big dog in the valley, which Mara was excited. She was sniffing their scents trying to catch one, but a little too fast for her. As we went farther in the valley, we could see that the trail split, as there's two big lakes, Rosy, Finch and Bighorn lakes. And we decided to, after looking at the map, following the trail, stayed to the right and followed the creek as it slowly rose from this valley. We hiked for a good half hour or so. We came upon a good resting space in a rock, and that's when Nathaniel discovered that he had a signal on a cell phone. So we stopped, we took a few minutes. I called my wife, Jerry, and talked to her, and Pat sent a text message to his wife. As we came upon this, it kind of got tight. The gorge got narrow, but we could see a small place where we could get through to get to the lake. And then we made it. We made it to Rosy Finch Lake. It was a gorgeous, beautiful lake. Another dead lake. It was too high up for any fish to live. Snow right down to it. We immediately stopped and rested. Pat and I, we decided it would be a good time to take a swim. We got into the icy cold water just long enough to get cooled off and lay down on this beautiful grassy beach. Mara did the same. The boys, however, they went ahead and explored this lake. Aaron found it fun to throw rocks into the water. And then we kind of lost sight of Nathaniel. And then suddenly we saw him way off in the distance, this little speck moving on the snow. And we said, it looks like he's going to ski down there. I hope he doesn't go in the lake. Well, we caught him on video here of him skiing down the rock on his, skiing down the snow on his rock snowboard. After about 45 minutes, an hour, we decided to move on to our next location. We hiked up. We couldn't see all of Rosy Finch Lake from our vantage point, so we hiked around this mountain of rocks, and then I took a panoramic view of the rest of the lake. We had an impromptu snow fight, too, which I didn't get video of because I was afraid it was going to hit the camera. We took this picture of these two keyholes in the mountain there. It was suggested that we go hike up there, but that's about another 700-800 feet. And we wanted to hit our destination of the second lake, which was Bighorn. So we hiked, we found this pathway between the two lakes, and then we discovered that we could stand on this one rock and we could actually see both lakes from this one vantage point. It was really cool. So here's Lake Bighorn. Well, I stopped a few minutes to take some pictures of the flowers and the shrubs that were just in bloom. It was springtime up there. Probably 70 degrees, and what a refreshing time it was from the heat in the valley, because I think this is the day that it hit 112 degrees at home. Well, we found out the only way to get down to the lake from our vantage point was to slide down this snowbank. Nathaniel was the first one, and he showed us how it's done. Pat, however, decided to take the safer way of doing it. So did I and Aaron. So we came down to the lake, and we decided it would be nice to hike around the right side to the island that was visible. So we made our way around the right side of the lake. And then the boys caught sight of the pass on the far side of the lake that you could climb up and you could see over and see what was in the next valley. And the boys set a goal for them to climb up there, and they did. They took the dog with them. Pat and I kept an eye on them. And the hike to the... This is probably about a... Almost about 11,000-foot pass. Meanwhile, while the boys were making their way back down, Pat and I decided to check out the island. And the only way to get to the island was to swim. So we swam over to the island in the icy, icy cold water and investigated the island. The only problem is we couldn't take our cameras and we couldn't take our shoes. So being tenderfeet, we both weren't able to really explore the island too much. Well, the boys came back. We made it back from the island and we had lunch. Took a few minutes, the boys threw some rocks in the water, skipped rocks, and then we headed back around Bighorn Lake. On the way, Pat spotted a dead mole in the grass, so I took a picture of it. And then we saw this mountain here, and we dubbed this mountain Paramount Mountain, because it looks just like the mountain from the Paramount movie studios. Very impressive in person. We decided to go see the outlet of this lake, so we continued to hike around, back around the way we came, but all the way to the outlet. We had to cross a lot of snow, and then we came to the outlet, which was really cool because you could stand in this place and keep be eye level with the level of the lake. We were searching for an alternate route back to our campsite, and so we did some searching. The boy suggested we go down the left side, but it looked like it was just a, we could go for a ways, but then there was a sheer drop off. So it was suggested that we just go ahead and continue to go on the west ridge of that valley and find a place down. So Nathaniel led the way, and we didn't go far at all, and he spotted another lake. This lake was on the map, but it had no name. And we also spotted a deer track, and it was just not very far at all. We were to this next lake, and from this lake the boys spied a way down. So we put faith in the boys' decision this time, and we made our way back down into the Marmot Valley. It was still a beautiful afternoon. There was some thunderstorms brewing in the background, a little thunder echoing off the canyons. On our way back, the boys went ahead, and I just leisurely walked and took in all the beauty and glory and splendor that God had created.
We stand and lift up our hands, for the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He? And together we sing.
Back to camp, it was about 3 in the afternoon. The clouds were threatening, there was still thunder, so we took about an hour nap. Afterwards, feeling recharged, the boys played a few hands of cards, and then we prepared for our evening meal. It was discovered that all this time we hadn't eaten any of our dessert that we brought. So after we ate our beef stroganoff, our mashed potatoes, and I made the rest of the potatoes we had brought, seasoned them up with a lot of garlic and onion powder, we proceeded to have dessert. So Pat and I had blueberry cheesecake, and Nathaniel and Aaron had their raspberry crumble, which they thoroughly enjoyed eating all of it between the two of them. Nightfall came on our third day. We stayed up a little later talking and visiting, and we headed off to bed. We all slept in, knowing we had plenty of time to hike out on our last day. We made our last Jiffy Pop, as we didn't want to hike it out, so we had Jiffy Pop while we were preparing breakfast. For breakfast, we had instant oatmeal, and dry cereal with powdered milk. And then we got all our stuff together. We found anything that we could burn in the fire that we didn't need to hike out. We burned in the fire, and we prepared to hike out. So about 10 o'clock, we started making our way out. And then on my way out, I took pictures of all the flora and fauna and flowers. I took our time hiking out, and so let's take a minute to look at these pictures.
The splendor of the key, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. It trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great.
God blessed us with absolutely gorgeous, beautiful weather. It was overcast, sprinkled on us once in a while, nice and cool. We made our way out in only about 3.5 hours, the boys being ahead. We made it back to the ferry about 2:30 in the afternoon. Having some downtime and being lunchtime, we cooked up some chicken noodle soup that Pat had left over. And the boys rested. Pat and I took a quick swim. Nathaniel brought out a cell phone to see if it would work, since he dropped it in the river the day before. And he was fascinated at all the weird things it was doing. Mara rested. More weary hikers came in. And we kicked back and really enjoyed ourselves. It was a great downtime. Pat and the boys played a game of BS. We kind of made our way over to the ferry pickup point as time drew near. And we discovered there was a whole lot of people waiting. And we were kind of worried because the one man said that only 14 people could fit on the ferry. And we counted at about 20. Good news was, when the ferry did come, they took everybody. We loaded up. The weather was a little different on the way back than on the way over the lake. Being late afternoon, the wind really whips up on Edison Lake, and there were white caps on the river, but that didn't make any difference to us or the ferry. We enjoyed a quick and pleasant ride back, and then we got in the, loaded up the van. We originally thought we were going to eat at Edison Lake, at the restaurant there, but discovering that their menu was limited for dinner and the boys really wanted hamburgers, we decided to move on to the next place at the restaurant, which was Mono Hot Springs. Pat did an excellent job maneuvering around the potholes and other cars on the one-lane road out of Edison Lake to Mono Hot Springs. We stopped at Mono Hot Springs about 6:30 in the evening, and we had a glorious meal of fresh salad, hamburgers. Some people had rice pilaf, some of us had mashed potatoes. And then we headed home to our families, home to our loved ones. Got home about 9:00 in the evening. It was a trip we'll never forget. the adventures, and the sights. And we thank our families for allowing us to go. Goodbye.